it would be appropriate to begin our conversation revisiting the studio of the artist, the place where the creativity actually takes place. And we see the studio, we see the materials, we see some paintings, work in progress. I want to share with you the thought that when Jean Cocteau was asked, what would you take if your house was on fire? He said, the fire. So here's the fire. Basically, that's what I wanted to share with you. Here the color sort of introduces the forms to us, and there is like an experience of a massive architecture. It's a mystery, you know? Because almost it's as if this painting has a source of light of its own. And I think of that, I realize that Adrian Stokes, that influenced so much of the thinking of Plotek, speaks of that quality of paintings, their capacity to create their own light at source, and he refers to it as the luminosity of the painting. And this is certainly one painting in this room that struck me for the strength of its luminosity. Coming originally from Mexico, where I was born and raised and exposed to the Mexican muralist movement, which was so propagandistic, so politicized, and so many painters opposed the muralism because it lacked the intimacy of painting. These paintings and their scale, although they could qualify as huge, you know, and they could be first cousins of the murals, actually they're closer in proximity to the small work of intimate artistry. And it is amazing how magical the scale works in these paintings, that although of great scale, they preserve an intimacy. They could be very teeny tiny paintings. They're, at one point we can experience them as almost like a miniature, you know. And that transfiguration of scale is something that I found very fascinating from my first contact with Plotek's work. But at the same time, I want to comment on the power, the engaging power of this painting. It sucks us right in. There's almost like a magnetic force that takes us in all the gaps that the artist creates. It's exactly like in a psychoanalytic process, you know, how a dream has what Freud described, a belly button of the dream, the heart of the dream, that acts as a magnetic force that pulls the dreamer into the associations. I'm hesitant in locating physically the belly button of the painting, but clearly I have a sense that there is a magnetic force. Meir Shapiro says, paintings and sculptures let us observe. They are the last handmade personal objects within our culture. Almost everything else is produced industrially, in mass, and through a high division of labor. Few people are fortunate enough to make something that represents themselves, that issues entirely from their hands and mind, and to which they can affix their names. A very interesting idea of a French psychoanalyst, Dr. Heide Feinberg, coins the term the telescoping of generations, which is the moment where an important element of transmission is compressed across generations. Sometimes it's a traumatic event that gets transmitted consciously or unconsciously across generations, or sometimes, as in this case, the whole saga that Spinoza family experienced gets telescoped into this pregnant object. No? These fragments of an object, the portable bed, that is not even there in a way, it's almost like it's there in the absence, manifests the power of absence, the power, the evocative power of the void. No? And that leads me to interesting thoughts about the role of emptiness, the role of void in the artistic creation. No? Around 1929, Melanie Klein produced a very important paper. The paper is called Infantile Anxiety Situations Reflected in a Work of Art and in the Creative Impulse. In that very interesting, fascinating paper, Ms. Klein relates the very peculiar story of Ruth Kajar, a woman who came to see Ms. Klein in 1929 for analysis because of tremendous anxieties, depression, and a sense of emptiness. Ms. Klein discovered that Ruth Kajar collected the paintings of her brother-in-law and filled her house with them. Until one day, and that pleased her a lot, pleased Ms. Kajar a great deal. But one day, her brother-in-law, the artist, removed one of the paintings and left an empty space on the wall. Ms. Kajar felt so anxious that she ran to the store where the materials were purchased by the artist, bought paintings and brushes herself, and started painting on the empty space left behind as the painting had been removed. When the brother-in-law, the artist, came and saw this work of art, he could not believe that it was done by Ruth Kajar. He said, this must have been only done by a highly accomplished artist. So this is a beautiful anecdote that Ms. Klein relates as part of her treatment and formulates the notion of emptiness leading to a desire to repair. In this case, she thought maybe Ms. Kajar is attempting to repair the sense of emptiness in the inner body of the mother, the maternal inner body. So she established a theory of artistic creativity, void, and reparation. Other theorists, Jacques Lacan, for example, a French psychoanalyst in the 60s, reading this paper, reformulates the idea more as a act of sublimation. He views creativity not as a reparation process, but as a creative process itself. And cites the example of the pottery jar or the jug designed by a potter that highlights the void as the result of creativity, or speaks of the Japanese architecture where a house is designed to highlight the presence of shadows. So creativity, rather than being reparation, creativity emerges as the gesture that perpetuates the void. So the more creative gestures, the more emptiness gets generated. And I like really that theory because that helps me explain why a painter continues painting, you know? When a painter paints, or a musician composes, or a writer writes a poem, they transpose a psychic reality into another realm. Christopher Bolas, a British psychoanalyst, calls that an act of transubstantiation. No, the object no longer exists in its psychic form, but it, in a way it reforms itself in the creative gesture. Is it a mere act of projection? Some people may wonder. Well, according to him, and I coincide with Bolas's idea, that it's actually a deeper process that entails a transformation, not just of the psychic, of the idea in the artist's head, but the artist himself or herself are transformed through the process, no? The process itself is the creativity, not just the creation of the painting being the result of creativity, but the gesture itself is a creative gesture. And as an aside, I want to say that as viewers, we are moved by the artwork, and the work evokes change in ourselves as well as participants in this creative gesture. You know, Christopher Bolas puts it in very beautiful terms. He says, in a psychically literal way, we are moved by the work of art, processed by its form. And even if we only glance at one painting, or we only hear a few bars of music, or read a few lines of a poem, we shall have been gathered by the aesthetic of the other, remarkably preserved in the after effects of their life forms, of their idioms left behind. Objects of this nature that impose the need in us to slow down are the strongest agents of resistance. No, against the growing desensitization upon which we are exposed in the so-called digital age. So the invitation to stop opens the possibility for free association. I guess it was in the 20s that a friend asked Mondrian, they wanted to start an artist's journal, a magazine. And they asked Mondrian for a title. And Mondrian said, stop! And the friend said, what? Stop! And he said, that should be the title, he said, because everything else is moving so fast that we can hardly apprehend it. I thought it was a great suggestion.
And my battery's about to die, so that's all we got.